This is Theater Talk. I'm Susan Haskins. Here with me is my co-host, Michael Riedel of the New York Daily News.
Titanic is in the news again. The film version just picked up many Oscars last week. Last year, we did an interview with Maury Yeston, the composer of the Broadway musical Titanic, and we would like to show you that interview again tonight. We interviewed Maury just a few months before the show opened on Broadway. Maury, welcome to Theater Talk.
Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be here.
Now, Maury, you know my first questions. I'm sure you've been hit with it many times. Titanic, are you nuts? Are you mad? Why are you doing a musical called Titanic?
All of the good ones sound like outlandish and awful ideas to start with. It's the ones that don't make it that sound like a terrific idea, like, look, let's get Leonard Bernstein and let's get Alan J. Lerner and let's do 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. But of course, what sounds like a great idea sometimes isn't. The ones that are challenging, like let's take a surreal Italian solipsistic movie by Fellini called 8½ and turn it into a Broadway show. Those things are interesting because it's something that you have to that you have to bring to it. But I get it all out of your system, Michael. It's not
a
musical.
Frozen
comedy,
Cavalier.
The Frozen Cavalier. There's another one calling it No Boat.
No Boat. That's right.
Well,
they sing, they dance, they drown. I think that was mine, actually.
Obviously, the musical theater has grown up, and we do more than musical comedy. It's musical drama, I've been fixated and obsessed with this extraordinary story, as have a lot of other people, sort of defining moment at the beginning of the century. Mm-hmm. There's a whole world that went down with that ship, when that ship went down, the Edwardian world, what Mark Twain called the Gilded Age. And as I learned about it, I became very passionate about it as an epic story about ordinary people and extraordinary people. The richest people in the world were on that ship, after all. The owner of Macy's, Isidore Strauss, and Benjamin Guggenheim, and John Jacob Astor, and they willingly stepped aside to let women and children in the boats, although third-class women and children did die in disproportionate numbers. But when you have a situation where people are involved in an epic, mind-boggling, astonishing drama, and where under one set of circumstances they behave one way and quite another set of circumstances another way, this really becomes the stuff of music drama and music theater, because people are so impassioned that they're at the point where they must sing, where we must get emotional. You know, where you have an exclamation in language, that's normally where you would sing a song. I mean, Frank Lesser said that's why so many of these theater songs start with exclamations like, oh, what a beautiful morning. And so I became engrossed and impassioned by the story and by the stories of heroism, the ironies, and what have you, of the tale.
Now, some people would say, though, you know, musical about the Titanic, that might seem a little depressing, a little bit of a downer. I mean, what's the tone of the show? Because we know, you know, the tragedy is coming and that these people are going to die.
Well, isn't that interesting? I mean, the audience, of course, walks in whistling the ending. We all know that story. And yet, you know, and I must say, and I'd like to credit the book writer here, Peter Stone, he wrote a musical about the people who had to sign the Declaration of Independence. Mm-hmm. And frankly made you feel that they might not sign it.
Very dramatic.
Even though you knew that they would. And here we are in a similar situation. Let's not forget, that was the launching of the most exciting dream of technology. It was the apex of steam and steel and coal that had ever been devised. Right. And it was presumably safe and unsinkable.
And fun. It must have been, when they first
they
set sail, it must have had a blast.
Of their lives. Yeah. I mean, it's like the first time the Concorde took off. Who had to be on that plane? Or the first 747. Right. It was elegant beyond all description. And at the same time, it had a huge area for the immigrants who were dreaming and striving to get to America. So the show is really about dreams. It's about the dreams of the immigrants who wanted to get to a better world, and it's the dreams of the second class who wanted to live like the millionaires, rub elbows with the richest people in the world and have suites just like them. And of course it was the dream of the upper class to have their predominance of the world last forever. And when that ship hit that iceberg, all those dreams stopped dead. And that's an astonishing moment. And it's an astonishing moment to carry forward and try to shape artistically in an evening. And I think the public really has developed a predilection for stories that are bittersweet in some cases. I mean, whether it's The Fall of Saigon and Miss Saigon, or whether it's Sweeney Todd. And so it's bittersweet. We mix happiness with sadness, and you know, there were some survivors as well as people who were regrettably lost. And so it's a profoundly human, passionate, epic tale, and a cautionary one as well. And I think as a writer, you know, what you do is you say, what do I want to spend 2 years of my life writing and learning about? Oh, even more than that, sure, but at least 2 years.
And this is very involved with what happened to make it go down. I mean, you said this is not Grand Hotel on the Water.
No, it's not Grand Hotel on the Water. It's not the Love Boat.
That's what
No, that would be a devastatingly bad idea to tell a bunch of fictionalized tales against the backdrop of the Titanic. No, it's the actual story of the people who ran the ship.
Although, is it not fair to say, though, that this is why it reminds me of Grand Hotel, in that you show people from all different classes of society kind of mixing and mingling, and then
there
something happens that throws them together.
There is that, too. But, you know, I think it's got a lot more protein, really, than the story of Grand Hotel, which is really sort of a slice of life. I mean, if you went to Grand Hotel the next day, it might not be a baron, it might not be a ballerina, but it would be that interesting sort of mixture. But in this case, it's as if the hotel were the main character. The Titanic is the main character. Mm-hmm. And the story, and who's in charge of it, and is it going too fast, and were they trying to be the fastest as well as the biggest?
Right.
And the owner was aboard. And what were his interests? And the designer of the ship was aboard.
Well, speaking of designers and speaking of the ship being a character, how are you going to sink? How are you going to sink a big ship on a Broadway stage? I've heard that you know, some of the actors might be suspended from wires above the set for the second act. I mean, can you give us a little idea?
You know,
it's
very interesting. That actually might happen, but that has absolutely nothing to do with the sinking of the ship.
No,
that has to do with actually an interesting effect. I don't think I'm giving anything much away. It has to do with our perspective in the way we see things. You know, Richard Jones, who is the director, I think astonished the theatrical community with his production of La Bête. And this, he takes some rather eccentric liberties, and I think to very great effect, with Stuart Lang, the designer. In demonstrating some interesting angles at which we see things. That's all. Well, obviously, we have to depict in some way the sinking of the ship. But it's silly to think that we're going to somehow take a model of a ship and put it down a hole in the middle of the stage.
Now, one part of the ship sank quickly, right? But another part sort of floated for a while.
The ship broke in two. Yeah. And the ship tilted over until the stern of the ship was 275 feet above the water. And almost 1,000 people tried to rush up, and some hung on to the railings. And then the ship broke in two, and the first half went down very quickly, and the second half took a great deal of time.
Can you describe the music for us? What kind of songs are
you know, it's interesting. Every show, Richard Rodgers said that every one of his shows had a kind of a key, a tone to it. He obviously didn't write Siamese music for The King and I, but there's a quality to it, a unity to it, as there is in Oklahoma. And I think it's probably, as a composer, that's probably true, that you find a kind of musical style or level. I think anybody who's familiar with Nine knows that it has Italianate and European elements. Anybody who knows My Phantom knows that it's French. It's a love letter to French music. I think Titanic is very English. It was an English ship. There are elements of English plain song. There are Irish people on board. The stoker, we've made the stoker from Leicestershire and Nottinghamshire, from D.H. Lawrence country. And of course, the show is very much about class. In fact, class figures very greatly in the tragedy. When that captain said, "Every man for himself," that was the end of the class system,
right?
I guess.
Are you going to have the orchestra striking up the song that they played? What was the song they played?
Well, interestingly enough, they played a song called Autumn. They didn't play Nearer My God to Thee, and we do have a song called Autumn, but it's a song that I wrote called Autumn, because I wanted to write the song. I didn't want to use any music of the period. Their story is true, and they were extraordinarily brave.
Band members.
Oh, yes, they did play on until the last. And I think this is the case, too. We all wonder, if I had been on that ship, what would have happened to me? Would I have survived? what would I have done?
How I would have dressed up like a woman and jumped on the rowboat.
Yes, you would have.
Are you kidding? I'm not going down. No way. I'm a survivor.
We've got that person. But I think you see, that's what it's about. It's about character transformation, and that's what's so fascinating.
Now, you're writing the lyrics to this show, right? Can you just describe for us how you work? I mean, how the Tony Award-winning composer Maury Yeston writes the great songs?
Well, sometimes the words come first, and sometimes the tune comes first. And under the very best circumstances, sometimes you catch a phrase in your ear that in which the words and the melody combine, and it leads you to a... But how I work most importantly is, before all of that, it's a question of where do we sing, and what makes us sing, and why do we sing? Once you find that, everything else follows and everything flows. You get to a point in the story where the story sings. And I must say, just making the Titanic as a story sing was a great challenge. And it was only when I confronted the actual people.
Right.
I mean, again, Alan J. Lerner told me once when I was very young, you got to fall in love with the people, and I hope you do. It was meeting the people and understanding we're telling a story about people who we come to know, who we become fond of. And then you find yourself getting in under the skin of the person, whether it's a captain or whether it's a flower girl in Covent Garden. That's the truly exciting moment. And then you find the words and you find the tone and that you catch the emotion of that person. And I think it's a big secret that composer lyricists enjoy, which is that by specifying how the words are going to be sung, you really get to give the actor a line reading. You know, it's really, oh, what a beautiful morning.
Right.
There's no way you're going to be able to change that.
So I guess that you also have to depend on your book writer, Peter Stone, for fleshing out the characters or giving you the moments that you think, this is the point where they sing.
Well, of course. It's a collaborative art. And under the best circumstances, you talk the show into existence. And you try not to write a great scene or a great song or a great anything. You try to sort out the story and the people, right? And then you begin to get a feel for those moments that really are going to be most advantageously dealt with in a book, and those moments that simply have to be sung.
And then
what happens is you end up not writing a song too early and falling in love with it and then having the wrong song in the wrong spot, but you don't want to cut it because you think it's a good song. That's a big mistake.
Just any fear, queasiness, concern, you know, the critics might have a field day with a show called Titanic.
They said don't call it 9 because the critics will call it a 3. Somebody else said, well, if it's good, they'll say it's a 10. I mean, no, not at all. You write from your heart where you get your best ideas, and you hope that people, if you do your work well, that people will share your vision and come away feeling as if they've been fed.
Maury Yeston, composer of Titanic, we wish you well. We hope you dock with the ship.
Thank you so much.
Very successfully.
We hope it floats.
And who undermined the position of captain? And who took a course too far north for the season? And who kept insisting we land ever sooner? And who should have two heads on the largest gun? Who did it? Who did it? Who did it? Who did it? Who did it?
So as we know, Titanic went on last spring to be a big hit, and for my money, it's much more interesting than that movie, despite all those Oscars.
Yeah, and it has a great score. I thought Maury's score to Titanic was just terrific, really good.
So
no boat, though, on the Broadway show. You get a big boat on the movie, but you don't get a big boat on the Broadway show.
I thought the little tea cart going down the stage was
much far
more
effective than all of the special effects in the movie. Yeah,
so
right.
What do we know? all right, so now here's our friend, Eric Bentley.
Some are children of the darkness. Some are children of the sun. You can see the sons of sunshine, sons of dark are seen by none.
Eric Bentley is a prominent critic, scholar, and playwright. He is best known, of course, as the translator of some of the great plays of Bertolt Brecht into the English language. He has a new book out called The Theory of the Modern Stage, put out by Applause Books. He has recently been inducted into the Theater Hall of Fame. And he has a show now running on Theater Row called The Good Woman, a musical, which is based on the Bertolt Brecht play, The Good Woman of Szechuan. We are delighted tonight to be joined by Eric Bentley. I'm curious about this discussion of theory on the stage. Is it your sense that playwriting, drama can be taught in a theory, or is it really something that is best learned by just sort of throwing a person into a theater and trying to write a play and trying to be an actor?
Well, the second is preferable if you can get it. You know, like the best is like in Charles Dickens' novel, Hard Times, he idealizes the circus as a theatrical utopia where people learn the art of the theater as children. Even at age 3 or 4, they're beginning to do the things in the circus. And so, obviously, the 3-year-olds are no more aware of the theories than the horses and the elephants.
Right.
But like them, they can do the practice.
Right.
So that's the ideal way. But of course, if people don't get that and are grown up with no practice, it may be that some of it then necessarily has to go through the brain, which it's a pity because it shouldn't.
Right,
you know, like learning about swimming without ever being in the water.
That's true.
I myself was for a brief time a student at the City University of New York in theater theory,
yes. In
which this was a major text.
Yes.
But I did find myself running screaming from the classroom because it was all intellectualized, and
yes.
There was, it sort of took the joy out of the theater.
Yes.
Do you ever find that in working with these works, that it all becomes too sterile, too intellectual?
Well, that's one effect. The other effect is sort of self-involvement of actors that think too much, because actors shouldn't think too much, they should act too much. They should do the things on what they consider intuitive grounds, which may be a little bit more complicated than just intuitive, but in no case based on a general theory. I mean, theories may become interesting later. Theories to begin with should come from practice, not dictate practice. Like Aristotle comes after the Greek playwrights, generalizing about them. Mm-hmm. He didn't tell them what to do. They told him what to write. Then from him, people might learn what the Greek dramatist did, because he's formulated it very well, and they're not bright enough to do the work he did for themselves. But you see what I mean? Also, I think there is implicit a theory in what people do, but they aren't necessarily aware of it. Mm-hmm. I mean, just as the elephants are not aware of it in the circus. But this, nevertheless, a scientist could give you the theory of elephant motion. The question is, what's the use of his formulation? It might have some use in the future, conceivably. Theater is not based on theory and doesn't come from theory, even when they think it does. It's based on tradition, custom, intuition, anything but a formulated philosophy. You can derive a philosophy from what they're doing, but that won't make other people do anything better. That's the kind of thinking that I do on it. I think it, of course, I'm now speaking for people working in the theater. Mm-hmm. For critics and students and teachers and so on, the answers may be different because theory may be their interest. Mm-hmm. In other words, they're philosophers to a degree.
I want to talk about criticism for a bit here. You are considered to be one of the great drama critics, really, when you were at the New Republic from 1952 to 1956, I believe. And you were reviewing a lot of the plays that we now consider to be the great American plays, mainly by Tennessee Williams and Arthur Miller.
Yeah, that's true.
But you were one of the few dissenting voices in just how good some of these plays were, particularly on Arthur Miller. Who was, of course, being lauded by Brooks Atkinson at the New York Times, but not so much by Eric Bentley. What were your objections to Arthur Miller?
They weren't really objections. Some of them were political arguments, you know, political differences of opinion, because his plays were strongly political. And I think it's not wrong to argue with a political play, is it? I mean, that's part of what a political play is for, mm-hmm. to make the audience argue about was he right or wrong and so forth. So with Miller, it was that way. Where I got in a certain amount of trouble in the arguments, or threatened with a lawsuit by Tennessee Williams and Arthur Miller, was because of one assertion that I made in an article where I said that the work of the director, Elia Kazan, made him virtual author of these plays,
Streetcar Named Desire,
several plays of Miller and Williams. Mm-hmm. and that they, I thought that their Broadway success was owing in very large part to him and to his work as virtual co-author. Mm-hmm. Well, Tennessee Williams went to his lawyer, and his lawyer advised going to Arthur Miller's lawyer, and so they jointly threatened to sue me if I didn't immediately withdraw this review, which had in the meanwhile come out in a book, withdraw the book from the bookstores. So I had to go together with a publisher and a lawyer and find out what how one does this. I was saved by a word that since then become very popular, the word virtual. We got virtual. Our dictionary out in the lawyer's office and virtual, not actual. In other words, Kazan didn't actually rewrite, right, fine. Right, right. I was awesome. Saved, I thought, but we generously offered to print a little slip that could be sent out to all the bookstores that had the book and placed in the book, saying that if I had given the impression that I thought Mr. Kazan actually wrote parts of the play, that was not what I meant to suggest,
right,
and we're sorry. But while we were waiting for the reaction to our offer, Arthur Miller fell in love with Marilyn Monroe and lost interest in suing Eric Bentley, I imagine. So love saved me from his hate.
We recently, just recently celebrated the 50th anniversary of Streetcar Named Desire. What is it about that play that makes it one of the great American works?
Well, that he can write, and the American playwrights in general can't write very well. Even those who have most craft and most to say, like Eugene O'Neill, there's still a great clumsiness in the writing. Tennessee Williams is probably the only non-clumsy writer that ever wrote for Broadway. Mm-hmm. And certainly the beauty of the language, and while it's also very colloquial, but it's a very artistic, poetic use of the colloquial. And he does that well. I mean, most of the playwrights try that, usually with New York accent, which doesn't work so well. This was this charming Southern right. speech. That was a large part of it. Plus, the themes were more, touched on more inside one, the audience, than Miller's things. Miller's things could be New York Times editorials, and practically were. You know, what the upright liberal American should be thinking and being out, what he should be outraged by, and he was, and people would make speeches. But Tennessee Williams plays are not like that, even when he touches on politics. They're somehow on the things that worry us deeply, mm. not the things we make political speeches about. Mm. And this was Tennessee Williams, very unphilosophical, very unintellectual compared with Miller. Mm-hmm. But that may have been good along the lines we were talking already, that
no
it's intuitive stuff about people's characters and feelings in relation to deepest conflicts, characteristic ones, and bringing in here he was a kind of pioneer, bringing in something America would then become obsessed by and treat in every play now, homosexuality. Mm-hmm. But then it wasn't, it was just barely there overtly, but it was there all the time, really. Mm-hmm. And it was, right. that was very important somehow.
The beauty of sublimation.
It's very ludicrous that when they made the Hollywood film of Streetcar,
right,
the bit about the homosexual element, which explains a great deal of the rest of the plot, was cut out. I understand that Mr. Kazan filmed that bit, but that Hollywood insisted on this being cut from the final version.
Right. Mm. On the subject of homosexuality in the American theater, is there a case to be made that when it was a topic, as you said, with Streetcar Named Desire, that you couldn't write about it so candidly and so frankly, that in a way the plays
right.
were more powerful than they are today when we have Angels in America for 8 hours where you can have it
yes.
all out in the open?
Yes, and that's a complicated subject too, because later in Tennessee's life, when he could write openly about homosexuality, it then became more like Arthur Miller. It was open and boring. Because it didn't have this strange tension about having to partly hide it and run away from it a bit and decorate it a bit. That created all kinds of tensions, mm-hmm. which were a plus in the theater. Yeah. And when it was bluntly coming out with it, you say, so what?
Eric Bentley, Theater Hall of Famer, congratulations on that honor. The book is The Theory of the Modern Stage by Applause Book. Thank you for being our guest tonight.
Thank you.
A great pleasure. We'll see you next time on Theater Talk.
Smoke from her funnels trailing, her prow like a knife, she'll cut through the waves unfailing. Soon to be underway, size and speed unexplored.
Welcome your questions or comments for Theater Talk. Thank you and good night.